It's good to see everyone on this beautiful day as we gather together to worship God. You'll notice that I'm wearing a different type of face mask today. I've talked to some folks who have listened to the video that we did and posted online, as well as some folks who have been sitting here, and they said that there was some muffling with the mask on. So I talked to some other clergy colleagues, and they are using these plastic shields. We want to thank Pam for providing this for us. So, in terms of announcements today, I just want to remind you that we are taping our service today, and I hope that you will invite friends who are not able to come out to view us. We will have everything recorded and online a little bit later this afternoon. And so, I invite you now to share in our call to worship. Dear God, during the hot and dry summer days, thank you for providing the cup of cold water we need on blistering hot days when our throats are dry and our hearts are heavy. Gracious God, thank you for your unfailing love. Thank you for your salvation.
Lord God, thank you for hearing our prayers.
Thanks be to God for always providing all we need. And now we look forward to hearing the special music. Now we have some time for our children, and we're going to take a few minutes to talk with them. So, boys and girls, I wanted to check in and let you know that I've been thinking about you a lot this week and hoping that you're enjoying summer vacation and that you're getting out and you're able to enjoy the beautiful sunshine. And some days, even on the rainy days, it's nice to sit and watch the rain coming down. But when I think about that, and I think about each of you, what I'm reminded of is how absolutely amazing God's love is. And how when we look at all the sky, we look at all the colors of green on the grass, we look at all the beautiful flowers, and I look at each one of the smiling faces of the people I meet. And you know, it's amazing, even with a mask on, you can tell who people are for the most part. And what I'm amazed by is how God created each of us with such beauty and such joy in our hearts. And we always want to remember, boys and girls, that throughout the week and throughout the day, it's important to just stop. And I kind of like to look up at the sky and say, wow, God, thank you for making such a beautiful day. Also, when I'm visiting with friends or family, I like to just take a look at their smiles. And I like to think in my heart, wow, I'm so blessed to have them as a friend. And sometimes I even say to folks, I'll say, you know what, I'm so glad we're friends. Or I'll say to my sister on the phone, I'm so glad that you're my sister. Or I say to my son, Michael, I'm so glad that you're my son and I'm your dad. So boys and girls, always be thankful for the ways that God blesses you, and always be willing to say thanks to Him for that and to tell other people how much you appreciate them. So let's say a special prayer, boys and girls. Dear God, thank you so much for your love. And thank you for making us. Thank you for giving us the gift of our lives. And today we also thank you for our moms, our dads, our grandmas, our grandpaps, our aunts and uncles, all the people, all our friends who care for us and who love us. We ask all these things in God's name and in Jesus' name. Amen. All right. So now we're at the time in the service where we recognize the gifts that we share. And many of you saw, as you were entering in the back, the little church building that our friend Paul built for us. And that's where we're placing our offering. So as we're thinking about the offerings that we give to support the ministry of God's church, let's bow our heads as we say a word of thanks. Heavenly Father, thank you so much for all the gifts that you give us, the gift of our lives, the gift of your love, and the gift of eternal life that you give us. And thank you for the resources that we have to live in this world, our homes, our health, our transportation, the food that we eat, the water that we drink, and sometimes we take for granted. Thank you for your never-ending love. And now we ask that the resources that you've given us would be used for the furthering of your kingdom here on earth. We ask these things in Christ's name. Amen. All right. And now we have some special music before we share our prayer time. Father, we come to you today and we give you thanks for the many gifts that you give us, the gift of your life and your son Jesus, and the gift of our lives that you gave us. We're reminded that the Bible tells us that we have been created in your image, and you invite us to live as heirs of your kingdom here on earth. Today we ask that each one of us would pause and give thanks for the many ways that we're blessed. Each of us experience your love and your blessing in a different way. Help us at some point today to stop all that we're doing. Turn off the television, turn off the radio, turn off the computer, and just sit quietly. Us with you. And reflect on the ways that we're blessed. Help us to always be thankful for the ways that you care for us. We also come together today and we're reminded that there are those who are in need, those who are struggling, those who are hurting, and those who desperately need to feel your healing touch. We're also aware, when we stop and we pause, that we too need prayer. We're reminded of that old gospel hymn. It's not my brother, it's not my sister, but it's me, O Lord, standing in the need of prayer. And the reality is that each of us have places in our lives where we need to feel your healing touch. Help us to do our best each day to be in touch with those places, not to necessarily dwell in them and not to be incapacitated by them, but rather to recognize that you are the source of all power, the source of all healing, that enable us to live in this world, and that enables us to go beyond the complexities and the difficulties and the despair that happen to every human being. Help us to always remember that you are the perfect healer. We gather together as a grateful nation, thankful for men and women who served in the armed forces in the past, those who risked their lives, and those who gave their lives in defense of the freedom that we sometimes admit that we take for granted. We pray today that in the midst of the complexity of our reality in this COVID-19 world, that you would remind us that there is much to be thankful for. Help us to look beyond our narrow self-interest and to look at the lives of other people. Help us to think about that old expression that we really don't understand others' realities until we perhaps walk a mile in their moccasins or shoes or boots. Help each of us to contemplate the realities of the brothers and sisters that you have created for us. Help us to remember that when the Bible tells us that you created all of us in your image, that you indeed meant all, not just the people who look like us, not just the people who sound like us. We pray today that you would be with the leaders of our nation and nations throughout the world, that you would be with us as citizens of our nation and the citizens of other nations. We pray that principles of honesty, integrity, peace, justice, and respect for the dignity of all human beings would characterize the way that decisions are made, not only in the great halls of Congress and Parliament and in places throughout the world, but also in our homes and also in our interactions with the people who we meet on the street, or who check us out at the grocery store, or greet us at the bank. Help us to see everyone through the eyes of Christ. We give you thanks today that we are blessed to be able to gather here in this place at this time. We thank you for the stewardship of many who have given us this building that has enabled us to have a place to gather. Help us to think of it not so much as a clubhouse, but to think of it as a gas station where we come in to get fueled up and go out into the world to continue to serve you. We pray today that we will continue to be blessed by the music that Donna shares with us. May it continue to touch those heartstrings so that we can feel your love and your peace and your comfort and your inspiration through the notes of the music. We thank you for the scripture, and we ask that that scripture would guide us and direct us as we live our lives. And today, we think of all those who are struggling, those who have lost loved ones and who grieve, those who are sick and are struggling to make sense of their illness and longing for healing, and those who are going through changes in their lives that threaten their very sense of being or threaten their very existence. We pray for comfort. We pray for healing. We pray for consolation. And now, we ask that each one of us would personally ask your Holy Spirit to enter into their life. As each of us invite the Holy Spirit into our hearts and our lives today, then we come together as a group of people, a church family, and we ask that we would be inspired today, and we would be blessed. We ask all these things in the name of your Son, Jesus Christ, who taught us to pray together when he said, "Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen." Friends, for those of you who are gathering with us today by way of the internet, I do want to invite you that if you have your Bibles there with you, that you can turn to first the book of Psalms. And we will be looking at Psalm 13, and we'll be looking at verses 1 through 6. Reading first from the psalmist, from the words of King David, a prayer for relief from the despair that David was experiencing as he was writing. "How long, Lord, will you forget me forever? How long will you hide your face from me? How long must I wrestle with my doubt thoughts? And day after day have sorrow in my heart. How long will my enemy triumph over me? Look on me and answer. Lord my God, give light to my eyes, or I will sleep in death. And my enemy will say, 'I have overcome him.' And my foes will rejoice when I fall. But I trust in your unfailing love. My heart rejoices in your salvation. I will sing the Lord's praise, for he has been good to me." The second passage that we are sharing today, I invite you to go to the New Testament, and we're looking at the book of Matthew, chapter 10, and we're looking at verses 40 through 42. "Anyone who welcomes you welcomes me. And anyone who welcomes me welcomes the one who sent me. Whoever welcomes a prophet as a prophet will receive a prophet's reward. And whoever welcomes a righteous person as a righteous person will receive a righteous person's reward. And if anyone gives even a cup of cold water to one of these little ones who is my disciple, truly I tell you, that person will certainly not lose their reward." May we be blessed by God's word as it comes to us from the scripture. Let's bow our heads for a word of prayer. Heavenly Father, touch our hearts and touch our spirits, touch our minds, open them all to you. And we ask that your Holy Spirit will guide us and direct us to hear the message that you have for each and every one of us. And God, I pray that the words that I share, either because of them or in spite of them, would be words that would give comfort and give inspiration and draw us all closer to you. We ask these things in Jesus' precious name. Amen. So friends, I want to annotate for you the essence of the previous verses in this chapter, because this is a really important chapter in the Bible. And it's one that I invite you to take a look at home, because it's a 42-verse chapter, and we're only looking, for the purposes of our sermon today, at the verses 40, 41, and 42. But in order to get the significance of them, you got to know the backstory, or as the commentator Paul Harvey used to say, the rest of the story. So this is a passage that occurs after Jesus has selected his 12 disciples. And now let me remind you who those disciples were and who they were not. They were not learned people. They were not learned men who had gone to great institutions of higher education. They were not people who had a lot of practical experience in doing this thing called ministry that he was calling them to do. It wasn't that they didn't just have training that was professional. They didn't even have on-the-job training. The training that they had was the same training that you and I have every day. It's called the school of hard knocks. It's the reality of living in the world. And so he called these 12 disciples out, many of them fishermen, and he said to them that I will make you fishers of men. And he told them that they were no longer going to be looking for fish, but they were going to be looking for people. And in verse 10, we get to the point where he's giving them the pep talk, the speech, the preparation instructions, the operating instructions that you might get on YouTube. It was like watching a YouTube video, which, by the way, I've not figured out how to watch any of those and figure out how to do anything. But the point is, Jesus had a way of talking to people that connected with them. And he started out by saying to them that I am going to give you authority to drive out evil spirits and to heal every disease and every sickness. Now, I don't know about you, but that says that he is giving them the opportunity to exercise power. He's not giving them power. He's giving them the opportunity to exercise power. The power does not come from them. The power comes from him, from Jesus, and from his Father. And he says to them, I'm going to give you the ability to exercise authority to drive out evil spirits and to heal every disease and sickness. That pretty much covers it. If you see the world that we live in today, we see that oftentimes there is an evil spirit that seems to be pervasive. I'm not talking about somebody who's running around in a little red suit. I'm talking about people who say things that are hurtful. I'm talking about people who have no sense of self-esteem and hurt themselves or hurt others. I'm talking about people who are sick, who are filled with despair, sometimes physically, sometimes emotionally, sometimes spiritually. And Jesus is saying to these 12 men, he's saying, I am going to send you out with the authority to drive out the evil and to heal every disease and every sickness. Now, friends, I don't know about you, but that's a pretty daunting, overwhelming responsibility. And when I read it, I like to say to myself, whew, thank goodness it was those guys. He wasn't talking to me. Wrong. He was talking to you and I, because we are the heirs of the mission that God had for us. And God is saying to you and I, when we accept Jesus Christ as our Lord and Savior, that we are going to have the authority to name the demons. We will have the authority to provide the healing. Now you say, wait a minute, are you talking about faith healing? Are you talking about one of the televangelists? No. What I'm talking about is the kind of healing that has to do with hospitality and the sense of caring and reaching out to people with love and care. And that's what verses 40 41 and 42 are about. But before we get there, we go back and we see that what Jesus was saying to folks is that, by the way, as you go out into the world, not everybody's going to like you. Are there any people here that struggle with what I struggle with, which is that I wish everybody would like me, because I don't like conflict. I don't want people yelling at me or screaming at me or disappointed in me. Jesus says right off the bat, I'm going to tell you that when you go out and you preach this message that the kingdom of heaven is near and you're healing the sick, you're raising the dead, you're cleansing those who have leprosy, you're going to drive out demons, you're going to freely you've received things, you're going to freely give. And he's even saying, look, I'm going to tell you what, don't even take a lot with you. Don't take along any gold or silver in your belt. take no money for the journey, no bag for the journey. Don't even take an extra coat. Don't even just take your sandals and a staff. And then he says, when you go in, and here's the scary part. He says, when you go in, search for a worthy person that will care for you and help you. But he's also saying, be on your guard against men. They will hand you over to the local councils. They'll flog you in their synagogues. And on my account, you will be brought before governors and witnesses and kings as witnesses to them, and they will arrest you. He doesn't say, and you might have that happen to you. He doesn't say that you might have people not like you. He doesn't say you might have people that will be offended by what you say. He says it will happen. And then he says to them, when it happens, know that I will be with you. So now, that's the background. That's the reality that each of us are facing. And those disciples were facing that day. Remember, I want to always be reminding us that we have to connect the scripture to our reality in our lives. I love history, but if the only reason I read the Bible was to see history, I would walk away very sad, very lonely, very empty. But when I see the stories of the Bible, I do understand them in the context of the historical perspective of the time when they were living, but it's also a story that's a living story. God kept those words alive for over 2,000 years, just in terms of since his death and resurrection. But all the words of the Old Testament, because they are a living, breathing guide for you and I. And so I look at them, and what I see is what takes us to verse 40 to 41 and 42. Let me share them again. Anyone who welcomes you welcomes me. And anyone who welcomes me welcomes the one who sent me. Whoever welcomes a prophet as a prophet will receive a prophet's reward. And whoever welcomes a righteous person as a righteous person will receive a righteous person's reward. If anyone gives even a cup of cold water to one of these little ones who is my disciple, truly I tell you, that person will certainly not lose their reward. Now, I've looked at that passage throughout the week. I've studied it, and I've prayed about it. And I have to tell you that I came up with some new insights that I didn't have a week ago. Now, does that mean that the words changed on the page? Not at all. What it means is that God is working with you and I each time we read the scripture to reveal to us. The Holy Spirit reveals to us what that scripture is saying to us today. Hospitality is such an amazing thing. And this passage is talking about the hospitality that people receive from God and the hospitality that they receive from other people. And I want you to think about meeting someone for the first time. And when you meet someone for the first time, you walk away, and I walk away, with an impression of that person. Now, we say that we shouldn't be judging, but the reality is that we do make judgments, we do make assessments, we do determine what we think of people. And as those disciples were walking into the community, they were not only saying to all those people that I have a message about God. The very way that they carried themselves, the very way that they loved on people, the very way that they looked them in the eye, the way they spoke to them, the compassion that came through in their voices was what gave the impression to people of who those disciples were. And it was not just who they were, but it was who they represented. And they represented God. And what Jesus was saying to them was that it is so important that you are welcoming with people and that you receive their welcome. It's not one-sided. I remember reading some things in the transition seminars that we would go to as clergy change appointments. And next Sunday will be the anniversary of 1 year of us being together. But clergy go to these transition seminars as they go into new churches. And one of the examples that they gave was that not only should we go in experiencing a sense of hospitality that we will receive from others, but we should go in extending a sense of hospitality. And they use the example of the minister that might go into a church and say to them, well, you know, thanks, it's really nice to be here. And by the way, the color of the walls of this sanctuary are absolutely hideous. And trustees, could you get that painted next week? And by the way, the music that you're singing is not really the best music in town. So I'd like you to try and go online and get some good music. And Donna, by next week, can you have that all memorized? All right. So think about that for a second. And now think about somebody inviting you into their home. Would you walk into somebody's home and say, that is the ugliest couch I have ever seen, and you expect me to sit on that couch? And now, of course, then there's the issue of coffee, you know. Are you really going to say that the coffee's no good and you're not going to come back unless the coffee's better? Now, you all know that that was one of my standard jokes with my mother, because my mother would say, why do you visit these poor people for so long? Why do you sit and just talk and talk at them for so long when you go to visit them? That's not very nice. And I say, well, Mom, I only stay a short time if the coffee's no good. And then I say to them, look, if you can't get better coffee, I'm not coming back again. And if the coffee's great, Mom, then I stay an hour and a half. But think about it for a minute. We go in to our relationships with people on whatever end of that relationship it is, and it's always the other end for the other person. How do we portray ourselves? And how we portray ourselves and how we receive from them the hospitality that they give us speaks to the person who we represent. And the person who we represent is in our heart, and it is Jesus. Do you know how I learned to drink black coffee? I went to visit a person who has become a dear friend, and we were sitting there at the coffee, having coffee around the table, and he said, hey, he said, do you want milk in your coffee? I said, well, yeah. I said, what do you got? He said, I have absolutely fresh right out of the cow milk. And I thought, wow, this is amazing. I will, for the first time in my life, and back then I was, you know, like 62 years old, I'm going to get fresh milk. I thought I would gag to death. Now, some of you who have grown up on a farm, Mark, I know Mark grew up on a dairy farm, and others of you grew up where there were cows or goats and you milked the cows and the goats, well, you may have acquired that taste. I switched to black coffee from that moment on every time I visited with Terry and Alita and Phyllis. And do you know that when my mom died, struggling with the cancer that Alita has, Alita was here. And that friendship is sustained. The reality is that we extend hospitality and we receive hospitality. And we do it in a much larger scale. It is one thing to say that we are a welcoming church, but it is another thing. And by the way, I'm not lecturing us, because what a great place to be at Eldred United Methodist Church. But what I am saying to remind us of the implications of this is that when we say that we are accepting people, when we say we are welcoming people, whether it's in our personal lives or whether it is in our corporate lives as a community or as a church family, the words are not the most important thing, are they? It's the actions. And the actions speak louder than words. And that's one of the first things I remember being taught by mom and dad. Your actions will always speak louder than your words. And it tells us in this scripture passage that whoever welcomes a prophet as a prophet gets a prophet's reward. Whoever welcomes a righteous person as a righteous person receives a righteous person's reward. What does it mean to be a prophet? What does it mean to be a righteous person? I think there's an intimate connection between being a prophet and a righteous person and trying our best to live according to the words of God and the will of God. And I wish it was a once and done deal. I wish it was like getting a measles shot and never getting the measles again. But the reality is we live in a world and things come up. And each day we are invited to see our faith in a more intimate way as we meet people who sometimes challenge us to the very depth of our being. Have you ever had one of those persons that you're talking to and you are saying to yourself, I've got to get out of here. I can't listen for one more second. Has that ever happened to you? And it's precisely at those moments where God is inviting us to perhaps go beyond what we feel and to act Christ-like. Righteousness and being prophetic has to do with the ability to invite people to wholeness in their relationship with God and with each other. Being a prophet is reminding people. And in fact, I remember the best example of the difference between being pastoral and prophetic. And that the professors would teach this in seminary. They would say, the role of a minister is to be a pastor to those who are hurting and who are uncomfortable, and to be a prophet to those that are feeling no hurt and have no sense of the pain of the reality around them. To be prophetic is to invite people to enter into the reality and the uncomfortableness of the world, to bring not our solutions, but the solutions that God, through Jesus Christ, has. And then finally, in verse 42, it says that if anyone gives even a cup of cold water to one of those little ones who is my disciple, truly I tell you, that person will certainly not lose their reward. It is so important for us to understand the role of children in biblical times. Children were seen in a societal way as a means to an end. You had children for the purpose of getting farmhands and people who would help you to maintain your property. That was a part of the reality of the extended family. And oftentimes, it was a culture that children were sacrificed, child sacrifices, so that these sacrifices of children in horrific ways were done with the belief that if you appeased the gods, I didn't say God, gods plural, if you appeased all these different gods out there by making human sacrifice, that then the gods would welcome and care for you. But our God, the God, says that even the littlest child is worthy of love. And even a little child is a disciple of Jesus Christ. And if you look around and you experience little children, it's such a joy to hear their stories. Recently, I heard a story about a family that the little boy was sick. It was Easter Sunday, and the little boy just could not go to church. So he stayed home with his dad, and the mom and the sisters, the little sisters, came home, and they said, it was just an amazing service. It was just wonderful. It was nice to see all the smiling faces, and Jesus was resurrected, and he was there with us at the service in the resurrection. And the little boy said, you got to be kidding me. On this one Sunday, and Jesus shows up, and I didn't get to see him. Children have a way of putting into perspective the fact that they long to experience God's love. So what's it about today? I think what it's about today is that Psalm 13 tells you and I that there will be days of despair. There will be days that we will be shaking our heads and we will be saying, if one more thing goes wrong, I will not even be able to figure out how to make things turn out halfway decent for the day. The despair that David speaks of when he says, how long, Lord, will you forget me forever? How long will you hide your face from me? How I must wrestle with my thoughts and day after day with sorrow in my heart. How long will my enemy triumph over me? We say today, how long will we wear masks? We say, how long will we social distance? We say, how long will the rates of infection continue to go up? And the answer is, we don't know. But when you go down to verse 5, it says, but I trust in your unfailing love. My heart rejoices in your salvation. I will sing the Lord's praise, for he has been good to me. If you're more than 30 feet away, you can sing the Lord's praise. But the point is, we will sing those words while we are at home. We will sing those words with reading them aloud. We will sing the Lord's praise because God has been good to you and God has been good to me. And what we will remember is that when we joyfully claim the love of God that sustains us and cares for us and draws us closer to him, there is a world out there, there are people out there that are desperate to experience that love and that acceptance. And who they see when they see us, who they hear when they hear us, should be Jesus Christ and should be God. And if that is not who we are showing them, the words that we say, yes, Jesus, I've accepted your call. Yes, Jesus, I'm going to be your person in the world, will fall on deaf ears. But go deeper, friends. Go deeper. We will not feel joy. We will not experience meaning in our lives. If we are in touch with God and we feel the presence of God sustaining us and carrying us, our love will be, as the sign on our marquee says, kindness will be contagious. And we will share that love with others. And we will be blessed by that love as we share that love. May we go in peace. Amen. Friends, as we prepare to receive the benediction today, I'm going to ask that you would be in a spirit of prayer and meditation. I'm looking at the clock. It's 11:17. I can't believe it. I weaseled you out of 13 minutes again today. This, as my Uncle Charlie would say, this is a big disgrace. But Let's take that moment of meditation, and then I want to read you a special benediction today. Benediction today, I want to share with you a post that was on Facebook yesterday. It comes from an extended member of our church family, and some of you who are friends with this person will recognize it, and I'm sure that this person will be watching our video today from the Carolinas. Sometimes I just wanted to stop. Talk of COVID, protests, looting, brutality. I lose my way, become convinced that this new normal is real life. But then I met an 87-year-old who talks of living through polio, diphtheria, Vietnam, protests, and yet is still enchanted with life. He seemed surprised when I said that 2020 must be especially challenging for him. No, he said slowly, looking at me straight in the eyes. I learned a long time ago not to see the world through the printed headlines. I see the world through the people who surround me. I see the world with the realization that we love big. Therefore, I choose to write my own headlines. Husband loves wife today. Family drops everything to come to grandma's bedside. And he patted my hand and said, old man makes new friend. His words collide with my worries, freeing them from the tether I had been holding tight. They float away. I am left with a renewed spirit. My headline now reads, Woman Overwhelmed by the Spirit of Kindness, and the reminder that our capacity to love is never ending. As we go out today, may the love of God the Father, God the Son, and the Holy Spirit be with you now and forevermore. Amen.
You know what?